Last week, we discussed several things. We did the credit evaluation part. We had consumer credit and then corporate credit, right? Consumer credit or corporate credit, main evaluation criteria revolves around 6 Cs of credit, right? Which is character, capital, capacity, condition, collateral, and cash flow. Right? So everything revolves around this. Whereas we derive other models from this C, 6 Cs, for the consumer credit, where the money will not generate any income, right? Consumer lending is where the lended money will not generate profit or income. Corporate credit or commercial credit is where the money will generate new income, right? So under the personal credit or the retail credit, we discuss purse, papers. Like that, we discuss two models, which revolves mainly around the 6 Cs of credit. Then we went on for corporate credit or commercial credit. There we had a model called MIFIRT. We were discussing mainly on management, industry, like it is the market, technology, management, then environment, risk, mitigation, like that, covenants, those things. Then we went on to discuss SWOT analysis, PESLI, and Porter's FIFO's model. SWOT is for micro evaluation of a company. PESLI is the macro analysis. Then Porter's FIFO's is a model which can be used to evaluate the market position of any project, which is five forces are competition, dependency on buyer, dependency on supplier, new entrants, and the substitutes. So any business, you need to look at the market, because market is the key in deciding on any project. Without knowing the market, you can't do anything. Why? Our aim is to generate profits. Then you should know how much we can sell, what kind of products we can sell, what are the preferences of the market, what is the target market, capacity, all those things we have to know. Then only you can decide on the technology, infrastructure, machinery, everything you can decide when you know the market only. Without knowing the market, if you decide on the technology to be used, machinery to be used, headcounts to be acquired, human resources, then the company structure, anything will be a waste. So first of all, you need to look at the market, then you can do everything else, right? So that was our last week entire presentation. Today, we are on the 11th session. We present it to you. So today we will be discussing the recovery and remedial management, right? So today we are on the 11th lecture. We have another four lectures to go, lecture notes to go. I will try and finish the lectures by first week of October, right? So we have three lectures more to go, right? Then you have a revision class on, I think it is 31st of October. November you have your exams, right? Right. Recovery and remedial management. Like objective of this entire session is understand the reasons for loan to go into non-performing, requirement for monitoring, EWS, and different recovery methods. What is a bad loan? Bad loan is a loan which they don't pay. Loan where repayments are not being made as originally agreed between the borrower and the lender and which may never be repaid. If a customer does not pay on due date, but he pays after 2-3 days or a month, that is not a bad loan. Right? That is arrears loan, but it is not a bad loan. A loan becomes bad when the customer does not pay and we think that we will not get money back. Right? That is a bad loan. Loans where repayments are not being made as originally agreed between the borrower and the lender and which may never be repaid. Right? Why do we need to maintain recoveries? Why? Can I see some answers? Can someone let me, why do we need to? Recover? Yes, to pay depositors. Someone else? Just one answer I got. They are part of our, yes, it is true. See, it is a social responsibility, right? We mainly lend depositors money. So we have to give that money back. Then when loans go bad, our cash flow get affected. Provisioning will come into play, right? Then profits will not be there. So you have a cash flow issue. Bank is not a charity organization. Bank has a responsibility to manage the deposits given by the depositors and pay them back and earn profits in that process. So it is a social responsibility we have. Then the second one is the impact and the impairment, right? That's why we need to look at recovery. Normally, this is a research done. Out of the arrears loans, only 5% we require to go into legal action. 10% recover without reminders. No need for a bill or SMS or anything, they will come and repay. Recovery with reminders means you send SMS, call, bill or anything. Recovery with effort, you will have to go behind. recovery through legal action, you send the LOD and some legal words, you will get 15%. 5%, we need to go to courts. This is a research done with few banks' data. Right. Then monitoring. Monitoring is essential. Credit supervision and monitoring. That is, like, from the day a customer walks into the bank till the day where customer pays and finishes it off, the entire period you have to monitor the customer, right? From the day customer walks into the bank to get a loan till the date he finishes off his repayments, you have to monitor. That is to make sure that the risk levels are okay, the same as what we expected at the time of approval. Money is being used for the proper purpose, right? So up to the point from the day he walks in and to the date he gets the money into his hand, that is pre-approval monitoring. So at any time when a customer comes in, walks in and asks for a loan, you do your evaluation, background checking and everything. Till the time you disperse the money, if you feel that you should not give due to any information you get, you should not give. We committed, it has been long overdue, all those things immaterial. Even if you think that we should not give this loan, at the time of signing, you should, can stop it. Right? So, monitoring prior to the disbursement is called pre-approval monitoring. Right? Money has not gone out, so you are safe. Then from the time you give out the money to the time he pays off everything, that is post-approval monitoring, where we need to discipline the customer. Right? Repayment, yes, this date you need to repay. You need to give us the financial data. You need to give us debtor data. You should allow us to visit. Insurance should be there. All those things comes at the post-approval monitoring. Right? What is early warning signals? What is early warning signals? Can I have an answer? Anyone has an idea about early warning signals? Irregular payments, one answer.
Any indication that the loan might go bad?
Definitely, yes. That is the indication. It is a traffic light system. Right? Is this. It is a like amber light which shows that any customer before going bad, they will show us that I'm going bad. But we conveniently ignore these signals, right? As a definition, early warning signals are indicators that can be used to identify possible loan credit facility which might fall into bad. That is the definition, right? just give me 1 minute. Daqui não, né? Right? So, this is an indication. Think about a customer who comes to you every day for a OD. Every day he wants the ODs. Is it an early warning signal? Can you tell me some early warning signals? It is an indication that customer will go bad. Right? Throw out some early warning signals you can think of. Prior to customer going bad, they will show us that I'm going bad. Delay of payment, yes. Right? Monthly they pay, but there is a delay. මෙතනින් කැලක් හරි ගන්න economic recording recording is right. Tell me some early warning signals.
He won't answer calls.
Yes, won't answer calls, right? Right, delay payment. Someone told transaction irregularities. What else? Continuous check purchases. Is it a early warning signal or what? Yes or no? Yes, only one. Only the same people are answering. Every one of you need to get the knowledge. Writing the exam is different. You can write the exam, but you need to have a knowledge, right? Continuous PODs. Is it a early warning signal? I have an answer. Soon after granting a loan, first installment arrears. It is not an early warning signal that is a bad credit. Right? We have not identified the customer properly. Right? So early warning signal is when the customer is paying you, suddenly his pattern of payment changes. You go to the customer's office, you see the manager changes every year also, right? Accountants change very frequently. auditors has been changed, right? Then the owner's wealth started increasing. When you go into the business, it is not only finance. It is a combination of things. You go into the business to see raw material stocks are not there. One side, no raw materials are. Some other day, you see lot of finished goods available. Right? Then all those things are, lot of finished goods means what? Product is not moving to the market. No raw material is what? Supplies are not coming in. So your business may get stuck one day. Right? Labor turnover. Manager and the owner fights in front of you. They have different opinions. Right? All those things are early on. These are cash flow issues. They are paying how much? Now it is 16%. 0.75%. Right? Do we have enough profits to do that? Right? So, whenever you see this kind of thing, you need to submit financials. They don't submit. You need to submit inventory data. They don't submit. You ask them to come and visit you. They don't. They don't answer the calls. You visit the customer, owner has not come to the business for several weeks. So all those things are early warning signals, right? So you have to be very careful. So early warning signals are operations, management behavior, reporting, investing. I told you, customer is investing in his wealth than the business. Financing issues. There was an annexure which I have not given. I will give you next week. That one. I have forgotten to send it. Right? So early warning signals are indications that customer will go bad. Okay, so these can be reported in different ways. Operational issues, management and behavioral issues, reporting issues, investing and financing, right? Then type of defaulters. We have two types. Firstly, like we take this side, this is the willful defaulters. You give money, they vanish. But other party, they are not willful. They are default by which is due to controllable or uncontrollable reason. They are genuine people, but due to some reason, they can't pay the bank. Right? Default due to genuine reasons and willful defaulter. So these two, you have to tackle differently. Default due to genuine reasons. There are two things again. Defaults due to factors which can be controlled by the customer. Defaults due to factors which can be controlled by the customer, which they have not controlled, like management problems, technical problems, financial problems, management problems. If you have proper management team, you should have solve some issues. Whereas I myself, the owner himself, try to do that, like financial management. If you have an accountant, you can solve this problem. But sometimes owners, they don't want to hire someone. They try to do the marketing, they try to do the manufacturing, they try to overlook the accounts as well. Technical problems. Maybe the machine breakdowns. Maybe capacity not balanced. Like that, due to some technical issues, customer will not operate. I have a case. We gave a facility for liquid explosives gel. It is an explosive gel, right? Where even underwater they can explode, right? So this technology was brought in from China. So this Chinese company did not give the proper technology to the local company. It took around 1.5 years for the plant to be set up properly. So because of this delay, customer could not pay us. So that is a technical problem, which is beyond their control. Right? Then management issues. We have a tea factory. The owner could not find a good tea maker. So the factory was not operating properly. If he had a good tea maker, that was a very good factory. So it's a management case where they don't have proper human capital to run the business. Then financial problem. I had a printer who is a very good printer, like quality printing, everything. He was one of the few who brought a 4-color printing machine to this country on the first go. Right? He brought in machine, he had orders from Unilever, Sri Lankan, and everywhere. And he is very knowledgeable about printing. But he was in areas always. Right? I did 3 or 4 reschedulements. Then I asked him, why are you in areas? You have orders, you know the subject, you know tech, you have the proper technology. Then he started telling, yes, I have all these things, but I don't have working capital. We underestimated the project cost when we brought in the machine. So we had to put all our working capital to get the machine up and running. I didn't want to come to the bank for working capital. I thought I can generate enough profit within a short period, so I can have working capital. But it is not happening. So he should have come to a bank and discussed his problems. So it is a financial problem. Because of that, he is in areas position. So these are genuine reasons. Customer could have managed it, but due to some reason, they have not managed, therefore they are in areas. Then reasons which can't be managed by customers. Genuine customers, like it is, genuine customers and willful defaulters. We are talking about genuine customers. Genuine customers again divided into 2 categories. Areas due to controllable reasons and areas due to uncontrollable reasons. Market crash. See, think what has happened to our tourism industry. Can the customers do anything? No, they can't. This is one very good example near yourself. Tourism industry has crashed. See how many bus owners are in areas now? How many hotels are in areas now? Why? No foreign tourism. Airline ticketing. What has happened to those businesses? Collapsed to the zero. And market crashes or slowdown. Political reasons. due to political reasons, my business closed. Think about what happened to the port city. That was a political reason. Right? Think about TikTok, WeChat. What is happening in the world? Because of the political reason, these apps are getting blocked by different countries. US has banned that. Right? So the people who are working on this app, they will have an impact. Nothing to do with them. Whoever selling goods on these apps will have a direct impact. Right? So those are political reasons. Environmental reasons are natural disasters, drought, rain, landslides, flooding. Because of those things, I can't pay, which is not controllable by the customer. Right? So, inaccurate, the last not the least, inaccurate judgment by the banker. Behind most of the arrears cases, we are also there. Right? See, we get our salary every month. 25th, normally we get our salary. Right? But when a customer comes, we don't bother to give the facility when he wants, he or she wants. Normally what happens, we take our own time and we grant the facility. By that time, customer's requirement may have changed, cost may have gone up. So those are mistakes done by us. Mismatch between the actual and the actual requirement and the funding given. Customer want a term loan, we give a POD. We have seen a lot of cases like that. Right? Customer wants to do a capital expenditure, but the bank has granted a POD. So this facility will never get set off. Right? Recovery is zero on that. So one day customer will get stuck. Hardcore PODs will be there with the banks. Mismatch between the actual requirement and the facilities granted. Customer wanted 50 million, but due to some reason, bank gives only 30. Who is going to give the other 20? If customer has money, that's good. Otherwise, he will have to go to someone else. Then comes the poli mudalal. Right? Or the project stops in between. Half-baked cake. So it is not valued to the bank or to the customer. Improper funding, timetable mismatches. I had a case. They were importing some machines. Our approval delayed. Exchange rate fluctuated. It cost around 4 million to the customer. We didn't go to give that 4 million because of our delay. We told this is what we can. So the customer had to pocket out that additional 4 million. So that may be his working capital. Right? We normally don't bother about the time taken. Right? We don't bother about the time. We go on our normal process and give money. Right? Think how many times we call a customer to come to office and ask questions. So when he comes to the bank, he has to keep someone in his place. Some other work they have to forego. Right? So we have to look at all those things when you are calling a customer for interview or something. Right? Action to be taken by banks to avoid default and non-payment of loan. Proper and accurate appraisal. Up to today, we were learning this part. How to evaluate a customer. How to evaluate a project. Then today morning, we discussed monitoring and observation. So it is again pre and post approval, right? Pre goes to evaluation, post comes to the monitoring. You have to visit customers regularly. Think about your customer. Some customers you may have not visited for a year. No, you should visit regularly. And again, you should not visit a customer after informing them. You should have sudden ad hoc visits as well. Regular visits plus ad hoc visits. Otherwise, everything would be set up to please you. All machines working, all are working, stocks are there, everything. But when you go suddenly, they can't make up anything. So, if you have monthly reports and all those things, we discuss about covenants, affirmative or positive covenants, and negative or restrictive covenants. Right, reports comes on affirmative. These are not restrictive. You just ask some information. Right, verbal information, third party information. So you can advise customers. You can share information. Look out for media information. If something goes bad on an industry, you can inform your customer. Right? Remind the repayments. No harm reminding. Always discuss with the customers, build relationships. The first to go bad is the bank without a relationship. Last to go bad is the bank with good relationship. So build relationship with customers, but professional relationship. Don't go out, boost with the customer, then you can't come back and return a check. For my 22 years of credit career, I have never called a customer machan, right? Maybe the customer is very close to me, but I have not called them machan. Only to the customers who are my schoolmates or university batchmates, I may have called machan. I have called machan. Anyone else, I don't. I always keep the distance because I am working for a bank. I should be able to say no to a customer when I have to. If I cross the boundary, I will never be able to say no. Many of our staff members who get into trouble is because they cross the boundary to the customer's side. We should remember that when a customer gives a glass of water to us, they expect a bowl of water from us. Right? So you have to be very, very careful when dealing with customers. Right? Advise, educate with customers. Reschedule and restructure. If you think the customer can't pay before going into arrears, you can change the repayment pattern. That is called restructuring. Right, if it goes bad and then you do repayment changes, that is called rescheduling. restructuring and rescheduling. If customer wants to repay, prepay, get it prepaid at any time. If you need to waive the prepayment damage, still get it waived and prepay. Whenever we are evaluating a customer and you see that there is a issue coming up, always try to get the highest interest bearing facility settled first. So it will ease out the burden on the cash flow. Right? It will ease out the burden. So your prepayments can happen properly. Other thing what we have seen is due to competition, we load customers. Right? Customer comes for a loan. You have to sell a credit card. You sell the credit card. We talk about cross sell and everything. You don't look at the cash flows of the customer. You load the credit card. You load the insurance. You load the lease. You load the housing loan and everything. Right? Then customer will go back. So be careful. Impairment process. I'll come back to you on this. Recovery methods. On recovery, let me know the above part will work or the below part will work. Top or the bottom? No answers. All are sleeping or what? I'm waiting for a chat answer. Top part, which is the negotiated settlement, or the bottom, legal action will work. What do you think? Depends better top. You are right. But always you should start with the negotiated settlement. Yes, first negotiate, then go for the legal. That's correct. You can't straight away go to legal. Judges will take the customer side. Right? Negotiated settlement. Compromise or corporate action. Legal action, foreseeable action and litigation. Foreseeable actions are actions like takeover properties, leasing seizures, those things. Matters to be noted by the bankers when settlement is through mutual agreement. When you are negotiating, you have to keep a very close relationship, very good relationship. You can't have a heated relationship and negotiate. You should have a very good, calm relationship, but that relationship has to be professional. That was what I'm talking. Constantly remind the borrower of his objectives. See, business people are there to do business. If they want to do business, always there has to be a banker behind it. Bank behind it. So for that, you need to have your payments proper. Why? In any case, what we look at first is the character, which is the creep. Respect the dignity of the borrower. You can't shout at the borrower. You can't put him way down and then start negotiating. It is one way, it is a tactic, but normally you should have a mutual respect to each other. educate through relationship network, right? You should educate from the network, but we have to be very careful. You can't pass any confidential information to third parties unless until he is in NPA, right? But you can say to his friends that I didn't see this guy for long. It gives a message that I'm searching for him. He may be absconding. Right? So educate them. Industry connection of the borrower. Make use of that. Make use of the friends to push him to the bank. You go into the business, evaluate the business, look at the actual chain, actual situation. Sir, gevanna vidiyanne floods aava. Go in and see actually what is the damage, loss. Because people are very good at exaggerating things and not paying. Right? So, you just can't listen to the customer and wait. Go into the business, see the actual position, see what is the damage happened, those things. Then come back, do the restructuring or reschedulement as required. Give concessions. If the customer is in trouble, give concessions. Sometimes you may be able, will have to give a smaller loan, additional funding, but give it. Then the business will restart. Allow prepayments. Right? That is the negotiator settlement. It's not only talking, reschedulements, prepayments, giving additional funding, giving concessions, but try to put the customer into proper repayments. Right? That is up to negotiated settlement. Then we have legal action. Prior to going to legal action, you have to work the negotiation settlement. We can't be a Sherlock. We can't ask for the pound of flesh. Right? You have to build a story to tell the courts that we offered him these concessions and we tried to assist him in his business, but he is not taking advantage of that. He is a willful defaulter. You should have communications. Everything has to be written properly. You should write letters to them offering concessions and reschedulements. You should prove that we have reminded, but he is not paying. All those things we have to do. After doing everything, if customer still does not pay, we go to legal action. We have several methods of taking legal action. Parate, debt recovery, mortgage bond, money recovery, winding up, arbitration, mediation, legal agreement, like that, right? Then we have two things called civil procedure code and criminal procedure code. Debt, I'll let you know that later. Steps involved in legal action. Before commencing legal actions, you have to make sure that all the documents are perfect. Without proper documentation, you can't go for legal action, right? Before the starting legal action, before sending the letter of demand, customer is in good contact, right? So when the customer goes areas, first thing, take out the file and check whether all the documents are in order. If all documents are in order, you don't have to worry. If not, get the documents in order. before starting any action. Complete documentation, correct and accurate document. Written reports, report of discussion, this is what I was talking about. Integrity and ethical conduct of bankers. Right? You can't take legal action while taking a discount from the customer. You use customer's vehicle for some of your personal reason and you are going to do legal. He'll come to courts and say, sir, I gave my vehicle to this officer. So you have issues. So first one, the fastest one is Parate action. This is available for all the commercial banks. Right? But specialized banks, but now we don't have specialized banks. We don't have this. Okay? Parate is a Dutch term, means immediate sales. Here under Parate, what happens is, you send letter of demand, first one and the second one. Then you write to the director board of the bank and ask them for permission to take over the mortgage asset. Under section 4, Act number 4, 1990, the Recovery of Loans by Bank Special Provision Act number 4 of 1990. Powers are vested with Director Board of the Bank to take over properties where the customer does not pay you. Right? So you write a board paper to the board requesting that permission to take over properties. Once you have the board paper approved, that board resolution should be sent to the customer and it has to be published on all three languages in national papers. Right? Then you have to gazette. Right? Then once you do this, you have to fix an auction date. Right? Public auction has to happen. You can't straight away go and take over property. You have to have a public auction. So you gazette the board paper, board resolution, then you gazette the public auction date, publicize that, poster gahanda, cutouts danda, onakak karanda. You have to publicize that. At that point of time, you go to that land, right, for the asset, near the asset, you do the public auction. Right? At that time, anyone can take over the property. If there is no bidder, you have to take it to the bank's name. So we work on a minimum price where we are going to sell the property. That price is called upset price. Upset price, which includes all the dues to the bank. If someone ready to pay that price, minimum of that price and take over, we are fine. Else, the property will come to the bank. So, prior to 2011, right, prior to 2011, we could do Parate for any amount of loans, any outstanding amount. But on 2011, Act number 1 of 2011, Parate execution can be done only for loans above 5 million. Smaller loans, you can't go for Parate. Then we have another thing called third party mortgages and own mortgages. Own mortgage means I'm taking the loan and the property owns by me. Third party mortgages are I am taking the loan, my mother is giving the property. Then it is third party. Prior to 2005, banks took third-party mortgages. Like Parate was available for third-party mortgages. Ramachandran versus HNB case, court said, you can't go Parate on third-party mortgages. You have to go on mortgage bond action, which takes a lot more time than Parate execution. Then came a situation, company and the company directors. Through the case HNB versus Jayawardena, again court said, company directors are not third party. Right? They are not third party. So you can go on Parate. Right? Then 2014, there was another case, Mudit Perera versus DFCC. Again, director's property became third party. So as of now, director's properties are third party properties. So whenever you are taking a mortgage over director's property, you have to make directors join borrowers. Otherwise, you will not have Parate rights. Parate is a speedy way of taking over property, right? But there are, you take over the property, you get the ownership, but physical ownership you can't take, right? If it is a bare land, no one is there, you may be taking the physical ownership. If the property is locked, chained and locked, gate tech wahalanan, you can't break in. So you have to file, once you take over the property, to take the physical ownership, you have to go to courts and file an ejectment case. Then you have to win from that, and from the courts registrar will come and they will hand over the property in clear position to bank. This is called ejectment case, which takes around 4 to 6 months for ejectment cases, right? Parate, you take over the right ownership, but physical ownership you may or may not take, be able to take. If you can't take the physical ownership, you will have to go to courts and place a case saying ejectment case. Then courts will give you the physical ownership clean basis, right? That is all Parate. Mortgage bond action. When you don't have Parate rights, we go on mortgage bond action. This is the way we go, right? You have a mortgage over property, you have to go to courts and prove that customer does not pay. Right? Customer does not pay. This property is mortgage. I have to recover my money. So please allow me to take over the property. Right? Summon issues to defendant, filing answers by defendant, trial evidence is led by bank with evidence, judgment court, executor decree. Right? So this is mortgage bond action. Then comes to the debt recovery action. This is nothing to do with the Parate like. This is Act number 2 of 1990. This amount 150 should be corrected to 250 now. I think it's changed to 500, but I will let you know. But it's 250. Right? There, without going on the Parate road, we go straight to the courts and say that customer is not paying. We need to take action. But only problem here in this case is you don't need to go Parate, you don't need to go on a mortgage bond, you can go on debt recovery. We get the courts to order the customer to repay. If he is not repaying, it is a breach on court order, which is a criminal offense again, But in order to go for debt recovery action, you should have proper documents. Once the plaint and the affidavit should be proper, and once you submit the plaint, you can't amend. Right? If a judgment gives you against you, you can't go back. You can't amend. You can't do any changes. So all the documents need to be perfect. Mistakes, errors are not entertained. If rejected, you can't file another case as well. So what we can do, we can go parate. If we can't recover everything, you can go on a debt recovery as well. Then money recovery action. When you have corporate guarantees, personal guarantees, those things, you can post data checks, those things, you can go on money recovery action, which is a civil procedure court. Here, I told you, I'll tell you civil and criminal. Criminal, you can arrest a customer. Civil, you can't do that. You have to go to court, prove the thing, and the prove that they are not paying, and the court should take action against them. Right? Winding up action, this is available only for companies. Right? Section 272 of Act Number 7 of 2007. This is the latest Companies Act. Based on that, whenever a facility is granted to a company, you need to register the mortgage bond with the Register of Companies, ROC, as well. Right? If the customer does not pay, you can go to courts. Under this section, you can ask the courts to wind up the company and sell the properties available, assets available, and pay. But normally banks does not go for this due to few reasons. Firstly, it creates a bad image on the bank, because when you wind up a business, it makes jobs unavailable, right? So there can be a lot of social problems, right? Second one, when you go to take legal action, wind up, it will be very publicized, and all the people who needs to get money from this company will come and join the case. So our positions get diluted, right? So therefore, it is very carefully only we go on wind up actions. Process for leases, at the moment of time, we can't do this. But on leases, we own the vehicle. We are the absolute owner. Customer is only registered owner. Right? I'm talking about financial leases. Right? So when the customer does not pay, we the bank, so the financial institution who has the absolute ownership, can terminate and get the vehicle back. We send firstly notice of termination, then we send the termination letter, then we ask them to return the vehicle, or we take over the vehicle forcibly. That is the foreseeable action we talk about. So that is very critical. Like, we give orders for a seizure to take the vehicle and bring it to us. We ask the person to say, we offer him a letter saying that, please bring that vehicle which is owned by us, absolute ownership. We never ask them to do a foreseeable action. We ask them to take it. Bring it, right? So it is very critical. At the time the seizure, take out the customer from the driving seat and putting him out and sitting on the seat. So that split second, it is a criminal offense. It is a robbery. Seizure, taking out the customer, if caught, is a robbery. Once Caesar sits on the driving seat, now it is bank's vehicle. That split second, it can go bad. So something happens like that, we are not responsible for the Caesar. We have asked the Caesar to bring the vehicle only. We have not asked him to forcibly bring. Right? Bank is covered, but it is a forcible action. So, notice of termination, 14 days, termination, then cease. And again, on top of the ceasing mechanism, you can go on procedural civil courts or the criminal courts. Under civil courts, we can go to customs, money recovery, like you go to the courts, prove that he is not paying, prove against the guarantors and get the money. Get the courts to order them to pay us. Or you can go to criminal courts, magistrate court or the criminal courts, breach of trust. In Sri Lanka, breach of trust is a criminal offense. Right? So you can go on three ways for leases: seizing, forcible action, civil procedural courts, or magistrate courts for criminal action. Then the mediation board. Any facility below 250 or 500, I can't remember the exact amount, I will let you know that next week. You can't go to courts or take legal action without going to the mediation board. It's a mediation board is appointed for areas, and the priest and the principal and the high ranking government officers are sitting on that. They can give a direction to pay. If the even after that, if the customer does not pay, you have to take a non-settlement certificate from the mediation board and go to courts and start the legal action. So all smaller cases, you need to go to that. Quality of security, insurance cover. Whenever we are going for legal action, you have to look at these things. Whether you have good security, take over and sell. Whether you have insurance coverages. Cost of litigation. Litigation is costly. Right? Impairment, how much we have impaired. Right? This is end of the part one of the discussion today. Right? Has he shared the second handout, the one I just shared you with you? Do you have this one? Okay, right, thank you. So, here it is the warning signals and all those things are here. Post-approval, pre-approval, those things are there. Then we look at this one. Classification of non-performing loans. Right. Classification of the non-performing loans. It is non-performing loans, NPL. NPL classification. It is of 2/4. Repayment or number of days in arrears or risk profile. I'll start with this. Customer is still paying, but if you think that customer will go bad in the future, you can mark them as non-performing loans, right? You can mark them as a non-performing loan. Customer market has gone bad, or customer has filed a liquidation case or something like that. You know that this customer will go bad. That is called objective evidence, right? Continuous reschedulements. Then you can make it as objective evidence and go to NPA, right? On the repayment, you have 0 days arrears. So we say number of days in arrears. Right, 0, 1 to 30, it is the first bucket, 30 to 60, it is the second bucket, 30 to 90, 60 to 90, it is the third bucket. Right? So, if a customer repaying well here, you don't have to worry. You just look at the recovery. Going into arrears, and they start moving this way. Arrears. This bucket, you just follow your normal recovery. When you cross to second bucket and to third bucket, we have something called watch listing. Watch listing. That means you tag the customer as a areas you need to monitor properly. So take out them from the normal portfolio and you have to watch this customer. So you have to quarterly basis, you have to discuss about these customers at the credit committee levels. This watch listing also further goes on to say, monitor and doubtful. They are in the PNPL. Pre-NPL. PNPL is pre-NPL category. Right? You watch with the customer. You are following very closely with the customer. That's it. So we don't want a sudden dip without knowing anything, suddenly NPL goes, then it is bad. So you watch list. Take corrective actions, monitor. If even after this is moving towards this, so you move from monitor to doubtful. Then it goes bad. Plus in this, it is NPL. Right? Crossing above 90 days, it is NPL. From the risk profile, you can watch list. If you are thinking that this customer will go bad, if you have objective evidence, we watch list, monitor, still it is making worse, go to doubtful before putting it to NPL. Right? Right. So this is the process: repayment, risk profile, objective, watch listing, and different buckets for staging, then go to NPA. Once the number of days exceeded 90 days or 3 months into it, 3 months arrears, we name it as non-performing loan. Right? This non-performing loans also categorize into 1, 2, 3, 4 items. Firstly, specially mentioned category, then substandard, doubtful, loss. These are the 4 types of NPL categories based on the period in arrears. Based on the period in arrears. Let me see. The overdraft period. Based on the potential risk. I'll explain this one later. Okay. This is the based on the period specially mentioned category. There are 4 tables like this. It is a pattern. You please keep a note on this. I have seen in the exams, they ask these things. Right? What is substandard? Please fill the blank like that. They have asked specially mentioned category, substandard, again it will give you a table, doubtful category it will give you a table, loss category it will give you a table. Right? So let's start with the substandard. Specially mentioned category, if it is an overdraft 90 days to 180 days in arrears, it is substandard. Credit card facilities, 3 months installment to 6 months installment in arrears, it is substandard. Credit facilities. Credit cards is 90 to 120 days. Other facilities 9 to 180. Like that. Number of installments and number of days is a pattern. You just go through it. Right? Then this one. When you have several facilities, when a customer has several facilities, if We are talking about the capital outstanding. When 30% of the facilities capital outstanding goes to NPL, the entire exposure goes to NPL. We say we have one L1, L2, L3 like that. We have 70 million, 30 million, 40 million, right? Which is 140. Okay. If this one goes bad, it is only this one NPA. Regular. But if something goes more than 40 million, 42 million, which is 30%, if these two go together bad, then entire exposure goes bad. More than 30% of the capital outstanding goes to NPL means the entire exposure goes to NPA, right? So we have to be careful when we are classifying recovery. Should not try to keep the NPL within 30%. If it costs more than 30%, it will have an impact, right? Then last two points. Reclassification, like I told you, we classify NPL based on the period, right? Again, once you reschedule or do something, we have to not once you collect everything at once, total area, NPL customer jumps to the regular customer base. But if you reschedule or restructure a customer, then you have a waiting period before changing them into regular customer base, right? This tables gives you how to reclassify NPL customer. If the customer is rescheduled, when in specially mentioned category, if he pays 3 months consecutively, you get them as a regular customer. Substandard and doubtful. You classify within 180 days or 6 installments. Loss category, you have to wait for 1 year. Right? You have to wait for 1 year. That means he has to consecutively pay. He paid 11 installments and the 12th installment he delayed. Again, go back to the first one. Again, 12 installments. So you have to be very careful when you are rescheduling. Impairment provisioning, right? All those things are there. I'll come to provisioning now. Why do we need this NPL different classification? We need NPL this classification in order to monitor these customers and recover. Longer the customer in NPL, harder the repayment, right? That's why we need customers to be classified and monitored properly, right? provisioning. Prior to 2012 December, we had regular NPL. Prior to 2012 December, based on the number of days in arrears, we had to make provisions from our profits, right? We had general provisioning and specific provisioning. NPL, you had specially mentioned substandard, doubtful, and loss. These are the based on the time. Time in areas. Right? You hope you can see the board. Can you see the board? Is it clear? Right. So provisioning was prior to December 2012. Still we do this. We compulsory, we had to do provisioning, keep our profits, part of our profits for bad days on general provisioning and specific provisioning based on the timing areas. If the customer is regular, we have some provisioning. When in NPL, some provision, right? Regular, 0 days areas. This is the 0 days areas one. 90 days up to 90, right? So any loan, this part, regular book, that means very good paid months, areas less than 90 days, 90 to 180 days, that means regular book means regular plus specially mentioned category, we took 0.5% as general provision. Regular book, which is 0 days arrears plus 0 to 90 days arrears, is regular book plus first part of the NPL, which is specially mentioned category. We took both these books at 0.5% provision. This is the general provision. Then, for these items, specially mentioned, doubtful, and loss, we had this formula for the provisioning. It is outstanding balance minus post-sale value of the property, mortgage, into 20%, outstanding balance into FSV into 50%, outstanding balance FSV into discounting factor into 100% for the loss category. Table is given. Right? In this one, specially mentioned category for credit card, this 20 became 25. Right? So this is the formula we use for specific provisioning. You take the outstanding balance, subtract the for sale value of the security into 20% for specially mentioned, doubtful 50%, and loss category is 100%. But we discount further, we discount the post sale value. This is 100%, right? We take 100% of the post sale value.
right? So credit card, this 20 becomes 25, right? So that is the formula used for specific provision. So prior to this date, we were using, we were doing provisioning based on the number of days in arrears, regular to specially mentioned category 0.5%, which is called the general provisioning. Above that, we went on to specific provisioning, special substandard, no, it's not special mention, it is substandard. It is outstanding minus 100% of the for sale value into 20%, doubtful 100% of the for sale value into 50%, 100% into discounted for sale value into 100%. Right, this is the formula we have to use. Central bank guideline, this formula we use. Right? They used to ask questions from this. Then So this is prior to, though we use this, prior to December 2012, we were using this compulsorily, but we use this today as well, but we use impairment provisioning, impairment, right? Impairment. We have two things. First, individual impairment and collective impairment, right? Like general and specific, we can term this as general, this as specific, right? But the difference between the earlier provisioning and impairment is this. Earlier provisioning was done based on the number of days in arrears, right? But impairment does not relate with number of days in arrears. Even without the customer is in arrears, you can provide for the customer. Impairment can be done, should be done. So it is based on the risk. Impairment is done based on the risk, right? It is based on the knowledge of the credit people as on the cash flows of this customer. If the credit people thinks that this customer will be in riskier position, you should provide. If the credit people thinks that he is okay, then you don't need to provide, but you have to provide a smaller amount. The process is like this. Jaini, I will explain the provisioning again once I finish the impairment. Right? Impairment is individual and collective. Provisioning, that means allocating part of our profits for bad days, was done on the number of days in arrears. Right? But impairment is done based on the risk of repayment for the best knowledge of the credit people. Right? So we have two types, individual impairment and collective impairment. As we have general and specific here. Okay. How does the impairment work? You have your portfolio. You have your customers this way. Customer exposure. Depending on the ticket size of the bank, bank needs to categorize significant, threshold. That means bank should decide if a customer goes bad, we have an issue. This customer goes bad. Like for NDB, my bank, if a customer above 25 million goes bad suddenly, we think it is difficult for us because our ticket size is in that range, right? Smaller ones we treat separately. Anyone above this individual significant point, we treat separately. So we take out all the customers. Customer A, customer B, customer C, D, like that. We take all the customers above the significant level. So it is 25 million for our bank. There can be a 50 million bank, there can be a 100 million bank, there can be a 10 million bank as well. Right? It is a bank specific thing. Based on your ticket sizes, you can decide what is the individually significant threshold. Right? So you take all these customers separately and look at them individually for objective evidence. If the customer is in NPL, objective evidence is yes. What do you mean by objective evidence? We see a risk. We see a risk that customer will not pay. We see a risk that is called objective evidence. If the customer is in NPL, objective evidence is yes. If the customer has been rescheduled, then objective evidence is yes. Then you see there is a market collapse. Objective evidence, yes. Then you see labor problems. Objective evidence, yes. Then you see continuous arrears. Objective evidence, yes. So we have several questions you have to answer. Then if objective evidence, yes, you have to work out the cash flows. Right? If the objective evidence is yes, So firstly, we take the portfolio, find out which are the significantly important cases. For them, we look at whether there is any indication that this customer will go bad. That is called objective evidence checking. Right? Once you decide, okay, these customers, though they are big, we don't see any issues, you can keep them aside. The customers whom you see issues may occur in the future, you have to take it separately. For those customers, you predict the cash flows. You have a 40 million facility, 36 months to repay. You look at whether your monthly repayments will come. You have a case, there all monthly repayments will come. You have another 30 million facility where you think first month you will get, second month you will get, third, fourth you will not get, fifth you will get, sixth you will get, like that. You assume that based on your knowledge, this. So cash flows you have to work out. Once the cash flows are worked out, you have to discount these values to today's value. You have to find the present value using the facility interest rate. Right? You work out the cash flows and discount the facility interest rate. Outstanding or the amortization cost minus present value is the impairment. This is the facility, original facility interest rate. So this is based on the knowledge of the credit officer. When will we get our money? Right? Right? Will be able to get our money. That is the requirement. So you find the specific significant threshold, take out all customers separately, check for objective evidence. If objective evidence is yes, keep them separately. If no objective evidence, keep them separately. For objective evidence yes customers, you take out the cash flows and project. Once outstanding minus the present value is impairment. Right? If this is positive, this is negative, that means present value is higher than equal to zero negative. Outstanding, you keep it to the other. Right? Here we have small case. Second, no objective evidence. Then third, we have no cash flow issues. Right? We have three types. So individual impairment is this one. This one. Right? Outstanding minus cash flow present value. If it is positive, that amount you impair here. All other things you get it here. Collective impairment, you get all the product exposure, auto finance, term loans, credit cards, you put it to different buckets based on previous 5-year repayment pattern. You do impairment here. This is a big calculation. 5-year past repayment patterns. Right?
Then this is the process. You have receivable. Is the loan receivable individually significant, whether it is big or small? Then objective evidence, no, you keep it aside. Objective evidence, yes. Cash flow estimates, no issues, it goes there. Else you do the quantify the impairment. Then you have the collective impairment, smaller cases, no objective evidence, and no cash flow issues. You put it to different buckets like term loans, ODs, like that. Based on the previous recovery probabilities, we do a calculation on collective impairment. So this is equal to general provisioning and individual provisioning there, specific provisioning and general provisioning. This individual and collective impairment, right? I had a question on general provisioning.
Just go through this. If you have a question, I can answer now. But please start reading the handout now. Right, we are getting close to the end. So, if you have a handout issue, I will next week first few minutes I will utilize to clarify any issues of today. Right, what we did prior to December 2012, this is 0 days arrears, no arrears, 0 to 90 days arrears, 90 days, so 30, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months arrears, 180, this is called special mention category, then 240, I think this is substandard, then you have doubtful, then you have loss, right? Any new facility or good facility, new plus good facilities plus all the arrears cases plus specially mentioned category, these four items into 0.5% is the general provision. Any good facility, right? All new facilities, good facilities, plus arrears cases up to 90 days, plus 90 to 180, that is specially mentioned category, that portfolio into 0.5% is general provisioning. For the substandard, doubtful, and loss, what we use for outstanding minus FSB into 20%. Outstanding minus FSB into 20%. Outstanding minus FSV into 50%, outstanding minus FSV discounting factor into 100% is the specific impairment. This discounting factor is called haircut rule. That time I didn't explain that.
Haircut rule was given here, I think. I'll give you the haircut rule one. They have not given you that. Next week I will give you the haircut rule as well. Right? We have haircut rule here. Here this one. We have a haircut rule which is 75, 60, 40, 50, like that, we have a percentage, right? So is it clear? Right. So prior to December 2012, we were using all time-based provisioning, but after that, we started providing based on the risk, right? Credit people's knowledge on the cash flows of the customer. So we had to find the individual significance amount. Then we have to look for objective evidence. Then we have to work out the cash flows. Based on the cash flows, we did the provisioning. Whichever does not qualify for that, we had to do the collective impairment, right? So this is the end of today's session. Please go through the handouts, and if you have any questions, ask me next week. Next week I will give you the table, impairment table as well, not the impairment table, the haircut rule table, right? If you don't have any questions, thank you very much.